Hi everyone, and welcome to this week's Family Devotion. We hope you've been enjoying our journey so far through the Gospel of John, and today we pick up in chapter 7, verse 32, and then we'll head right into chapter 8 and eventually landing at verse 11. Now, before we pause the video, pray, and read the passage, I wanted to give you the context and just a bit of an overview of where we find ourselves today. Jesus has been amazing the people with his teaching. They wonder where he got the information he's been giving them, since he never studied at the rabbinical centers for learning. So many begin accusing the incarnate word as uneducated, despite the knowledge and wisdom that he's displaying. And we run across this all the time. Many will ask, hey, where did you go to seminary? As if that's the sole requirement to know and understand God's word. Now, while seminary is certainly helpful, it's not a requirement. To know God's word and to understand it correctly, all you need is first love for God, which then produces a hunger to know him better. And as a believer, you have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of you. And Jesus said, the Spirit is your teacher. He will teach you all things. Now that said, the value I've personally found in going to seminary is that it forces me to consume a ton of information that, unless I'm credibly self-driven, I wouldn't consume the volume of information that's been given to me in seminary on my own. In fact, many times I find it's like drinking through a fire hose. A lot goes in, but even more escapes. And personally, I find the pace to be quite painful at times, to say the least. But whether you're in seminary or not, we're commanded to love the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. So by loving God and asking him in prayer to make us hungry for more of him, he gives us this hunger that drives us to want to know him better. But in the case of Jesus, he said, my teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. It's no wonder then that some had recognized him as one who had authority and not as the scribes in verses like Mark 1:22. So the teaching of Jesus stands in contrast to those who are motivated by their unregenerate hearts, who desire their own personal honor rather than God's. For Jesus said in verse 18 of our text today that the one who speaks on his own authority seeks his own glory, but the one who seeks the glory of God is true, and in him there is no falsehood. And his command, in light of that fact, is to urge the people to not judge by appearances, but instead on right judgment. And then this begins stirring up all kinds of reactions. Some remain indifferent, some want to do away with Jesus all the more, and yet some truly believe. So where our text picks up today, we'll see these reactions begin to unfold. It will cause a division among the people. And even though his hour had not yet come, the conflict between Jesus and the religious establishment continues to escalate. And once again, we see some of them withdrawing from Jesus. Then he goes up to the Mount of Olives for the night. And in the morning, he comes down to teach in the temple again. Only this time, the religious leaders will bring him a woman who was caught in adultery to test Jesus in order to bring a charge against him. And Jesus will use this as an opportunity to turn it over on their own heads as he uses the law to condemn them. So that's the overview. Now's a good time to stop and pause the video and pray, asking God to illuminate the scriptures for you, then read the passage, and then come back to me when you're finished. Okay, so hopefully you've just prayed and read the passage. Let's begin discussing what God wants us to see here today. So having established his relationship to the Father, saying, I know him, for I come from him, and he sent me, Jesus talks about that relationship in terms of the goal that he has. He says, I will be with you a little longer, and then I'm going to him who sent me, and as a result, they won't be able to find him. The crowds, misunderstanding once again, interpret what Jesus is saying to be referring to some other mission that he has in mind. They think he's talking about going to the scattered groups of Jews who live among the Gentiles. Now, interestingly enough, they're not completely wrong in that, because Jesus does have a plan for these groups of Jews and the Gentiles that exist among them. But in order for these plans to be accomplished, he must first go to the cross, die, and then raise from the dead. Then he will go back to the Father, which will result in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which will enable his followers to obey the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. So Jesus continues to be very deliberate in moving forward in accomplishing God's plan of redemption. He will sit down at the right hand of God and direct through his Spirit the fulfillment of all God's purposes and salvation throughout all ages. Now, since this was a concept that not many, if any, could truly grasp, a division occurs among the people here, and it says that they each went to their own house. And this is when Jesus goes up to the Mount of Olives to spend the night. The next day, he begins teaching the people once again in the temple, and the religious leaders now use this as an opportunity to test Jesus, and the trickery of these leaders really display quite a crafty trickery, to say the least. So they bring him a woman who's been caught in adultery, and they place her front and center so that everyone around them can bear witness to what they think will be the demise of Jesus. Now, the punishment prescribed in the Old Testament law for adultery was death. Now, the trick they've planned is that if Jesus tells them to carry out the stoning, he would violate Roman law because only Romans have the right to execute the death penalty. And on the other hand, if Jesus tells them not to stone her, then he would be guilty of breaking the Mosaic law. You can almost see the religious leaders kind of rubbing their hands together, snickering, and kind of hopeful expectation of Jesus' demise here. They want to justify their rejection of Jesus. Basically, Jesus had developed a reputation for having compassion on the downtrodden and the outcast and the lawless, and they knew that much really well. So they think by acting on his compassion that Jesus would discredit himself in the eyes of the people. But what they fail to realize is that Jesus knows what's inside of man. You can't fool the sovereign God of the universe. He's omniscient and he knows all things. So in response to their cleverly devised scheme, Jesus does something really interesting. He bends down and he begins to write on the ground. Now, though we all want to know exactly what Jesus wrote, the text doesn't tell us. What we do know is that God had used his finger to write the law on stone tablets at Mount Sinai. So the assumption here is that Jesus wrote down the Ten Commandments. So Jesus, after writing these things, says, "Let him who's without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her." Then he bends down again. He writes something else on the ground, to which at this point people suspect that he writes actually specific sins of the accusers that only God himself would know. And what Jesus is showing us here is the need for consistency in passing judgment. Remember, the log is in our own eye. He's revealing that the sword of judgment is a double-edged blade. So by judging others, we judge ourselves. And by not judging ourselves according to our own sin, we certainly don't maintain the right to judge others according to theirs. So one by one, they begin to slip away. In conclusion, we learn a couple things from our text today. First, we'll be judged by the same standard that we judge others. We should first address the log in our own eye before pointing out the speck in someone else's. God's call for all of us is that we live holy and godly lives. And we can't possibly call others to do that unless we ourselves are living up to that. To do otherwise would be what's called a hypocrite. Second, we need to preach the reality of God's forgiveness constantly, first to ourselves, but also to other people who will at some point stumble or even perhaps run headfirst into sinful behavior. When someone has a broken conscience and confesses their sins to you, will you point them to God's forgiveness and say, "Neither do I condemn you," or will you begin collecting stones by which to pronounce your judgment on them? Remember, mercy triumphs over judgment, and God will be merciless to the one who's shown no mercy. But at the same time, Jesus didn't just forgive this woman's sins and tell her to go about doing the same old. He said, "Go, and from now on, sin no more." That's called bearing fruit in keeping with repentance. For example, if I tell my wife I'm sorry for this or I'm sorry for not doing that, does it demonstrate that I'm truly sorry if I keep doing or not doing the same thing over and over again? You see, forgiveness is not an end to itself. It demands something from our lives. So as you consider these points as we close this week's devotion, I'd like for you to discuss and pray over the closing questions that are going to be posted on the screen for you. And remember, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So may God bless you in your time of self-examination this week and help you remember that there's now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Thank you so much for watching today. We look forward to meeting again next week as we continue our journey through the Gospel of John together. And again, spend some time in reflection on those questions. We'll see you next time.